Bishut, Moray, Rabotev, the permission of Hashem, peace God, next week, it's Matan Torah. And this year we have 3 days of Shavuot. Shabbat, then Sunday and Monday. It's a long, long, long Matan Torah. Usually, when you think about Matan Torah, the donation of the Torah. Matan, it's a matana, it's a gift. The question is, do we feel that gift that Hashem gives us? It is a gift. You bought a nice car to your wife. It's a gift. She's happy. You buy to your wife some jewelry, big ring. It's a gift. She's happy. How long that happiness will last? The time that she will forget the gift she got from her husband. The first days she will look at her hands. She will go to the mirror to see the bracelets. She will watch the car. And then she will get used to it. She forgot about the gift because this is life. So, what is the difference between the gift that Hashem gives us, the gift that a man, a husband, gives to his wife? What is the difference? The gift that the husband gives to his wife, you can see it. She can see the ring. But she will be excited, she will be happy, and then she will forget about the gift. Then maybe one day she will scream at her husband. There can be a fight. Already she forgot about the gift that she got. Big diamond ring. She forgot about it. The gift of Hashem give us the Torah. Do we see the gift? The husband gives to his wife the gift, she sees the gift. And the husband, he bought the gift and he gave it to her. And he's happy because she's happy. Now, the Torah, it's a gift. Do we feel the Torah as a gift? Or we feel it as what? Are we happy? Is he happy? What's going on? But the Torah is a matana. The Torah is a gift. The answer is, a gift that a husband gives to his wife, or a gift that a man gives to his friend, this gift, it's only a gift that was made in this world. And this gift, it will not last longer in the mind of the person that he received it. The Torah is kind of a gift that Hashem gives. When Hashem gives something, He knows what he gives. He gives life. The gift that the husband gives to his wife, that gift could be lost. It's like last week, a man received a beautiful watch, very expensive, and he lost it the same day. So, he was the one who gave him the gift. He was happy. When he received it, he was happy. And then both of them are not happy. The watch was lost. The gift that Hashem gives, Hashem is happy to give it. And if we know the value of that gift, we can be happy. And we will not lose it if we know how to keep it. This is a gift. This gift came from up there, from the Shamayim, from Hashem. Because the one who gives that gift, he knows what he's giving. Now, in that gift will never be lost. Now, the only one who can lose it, it's you, the man who receives it. He may lose it. But Hashem, if the man, he will lose it, the gift that he received from Hashem, that gift will go back to Hashem again. Understand? This is the difference between a man's gift and Hashem's gift. Hashem's gift, can never be lost. It's beautiful. It's good. It's pleasure. When Hashem give it with happiness. And the one who receives it, it depends on him how he will accept it. If he knows the value of the Torah, he will be happy. He will not lose it. And if he loses it, so he's the loser, not God. Because the Torah will go back to Hashem. The Torah never will be lost. Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, they studied Torah before the Torah was given. What kind of Torah they studied? This is the question that we see it's like the Gemara said. This is the Gemara said that the Jews in Egypt they were studying Torah. So Maran Rav Shach Alav Shalom, he asked a question. He said, "What kind of Torah they were studying? What kind of Torah? I mean, the Torah was given 300 years later. I mean, what kind of Torah they study? And what kind of Torah Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov study? What kind of Torah the Jews in Egypt? Because the Gemara said that the Jews in Egypt they studied Torah. This Midrash Rabbah." That the Bnei said they had some Torah that they received from their parents. And every Shabbos they will use it. They were slaves, poor people. But at least the Torah gives them some pleasure. And what was written in this Torah? You know what was written? It was written Bereshit Bara Elokim. How Hashem created the world. That is Torah. The word that Hashem said to Adam Arishon, that Hashem said to Adam Arishon, Adam, don't eat this, eat that, and what the names of these animals, and what was the Torah, the way that Hashem said to Noah, I'm going to destroy the world, and build a teva. This is the Torah. And that's the Torah that Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov studied. And then Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, they wrote their life. That was the Torah. And they wrote that Abraham, he went to Egypt. And then he said to Sarah, please Sarah, if they ask you, who are you? Don't tell you my wife. Tell you my sister. That was the kind of Torah. Now please. And that the kind of the Torah. That was the Torah that they studied our parents, Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, the Jews in Egypt, before Hashem gave the Torah. Now, do you think this is Torah? I mean, what is this Torah? Torah, it's a learning. I learn mitzvot. This is Torah. Like the Ten Commandments. This is Torah. But a history, it's Torah. The answer is, how can you execute the mitzvot if you don't have any people who were serving already Hashem? I mean, from the history that the way Hashem created the world, the way Abraham Avinu he behaved, the way that Yitzhak Avinu was a tzaddik, that was Torah. Sometimes there is people that they're very cold. They're very good people. You talk to them about God, they will not look at you. You will talk to them about what Hashem wants from us, about mitzvot, don't go with a woman that she's nida, don't do this. They will laugh at you. They will laugh at you. But when you study history, you look, it's always in my office, I have pictures of my grandfather and pictures of rabbis. You know why? Because I learn from them. I learn from what they did. You understand? And now because I learn from what they did, so that it gives me an open mind. to respect. And when I look at the picture of my grandfather, I say to myself, if he was good with Hashem, so I have to be good with Hashem. I learned from Abraham Avinu the sacrifice that he did to Yitzhak. I learned from Abraham Avinu, all Hashem told him, go to Egypt. Can you imagine? Hashem said to Abraham, go to Eretz Canaan. He arrived to Eretz Canaan. Hashem said, this is the best country that I want to give you and to give you your children. Suddenly, there is no food. Then Hashem said to Abraham, go to Egypt. I mean, it's a big test. I was with my parents. I was well there. I had nothing. I had no problem there. Abraham had a big yeshiva in Haran. He was a happy man. And then Hashem said, get out, leave this country, leave your house, leave your family, and go to that land that even he did not tell him where to go. And he went. And learned from here, whatever Hashem said to do, do it. No doubt. That's its Torah. Only from that. So if Hashem give me mitzvah to do, I will do it. I will say to myself, Abraham, he did it. Hashem said to Abraham, go to the land that I will show you. He did not even tell him where to go, and he went. So if Abraham did that, so what's problem with me if Hashem tell me not to touch a woman that she's nida? Abraham Avinu, he did more than me. That's Torah. Then Abraham Avinu arrived to Eretz Israel, and Hashem said, this is the land I get. Ah, it's beautiful, wow. And then there was no food, no rain, starving, people dying. And Abraham, he did not say nothing, no word, but he started to visit Israel, Eretz Canaan. And then there was no food to give to his student, to his followers, all the people that they came with him from Haran, nothing to give. So Hashem said to him, Abraham, in Egypt, there is their food. Go to Egypt. But Hashem, you told me this is the best country. Now Egypt is the best country. And Abraham did not ask question. He went. Now there is a problem. He said to his wife, Madam, you are my wife, you are pretty. If you tell them you are my wife, they kill me. So tell them you are my sister. So the question that children ask me, if Abraham believe in Hashem, if Abraham has emunah in Hashem, what the problem? Why you don't tell them it's my wife? And besides this, he went to Egypt with the order of Hashem. So Hashem, he has to take care of his wife. Why he has to lie? All the time we saw twice Abraham, he said to Abimelech, it's my sister. Then once it's Hakabino as well, he said, it's my sister. What's going on? The answer is this. This is really the answer. That Abraham Abinu, he wants to teach us that we have to do ishtadlut. What it is, you have to do effort. And before Abraham, there is no problem to tell them, she's my wife. Only Abraham was worried about something. What he was worried? He was worried that maybe, God forbid, that something, listen to this, Abraham wanted to teach us something, that in life you have to do ishtadlut. Yes, Hashem told me to go to Egypt. And of course, Hashem will protect me. But what about? Maybe I will do something bad. The Egyptian, they love pretty woman. Maybe I will do an avera. And because I will do this avera, I'll be without protection. And if I'm not without protection, maybe they kill me. And I give you an idea. Hashem said to Shmuel, the prophet, Shmuel, I want you to go to Bethlehem, choose out of the seven children that Yishai has, I want from there a boy that he will be the king of Israel. And at that time, the king Shaul was alive. Now Shmuel and Navi, he went to Bethlehem. When he arrived to Bethlehem, all the city, they were surprised. Why did he come now? He didn't want to tell them that I came for to choose one son from Yishai to be the king. Why? Because he was worried that the king will listen and he will kill him. So the question is, but Hashem told you, what the worry? Hashem, he told you, go to Bethlehem, choose one son out of the 7 children that Yishai has. So what the worry? And beside it, Hashem, he did not say to Shmuel, who? Why Hashem did not say to Shmuel the name? Tell him the name. Tell him, go to Bethlehem, and there is David, Yishai has 7 children, take David. I choose David. But Shmuel, when he arrived, they asked him, yes, what's going on? He said, no, I came here to do a sacrifice. And I want to do the sacrifice in the house of Yishai. So Yishai, he was happy to receive the prophet. So all the children were there. And then Shmuel said to Yishai, Yishai, can you show me your children? He came the first one. No, not this one. The second, no, not this one. And then, after 6 children, he said, this is at Tamuan Arim, there is no more children. Yeah, there is the small one, but he's in the desert, you know, with the he's a berger. He take care of the lamb, he take care of the animals. Maybe it's him that Hashem will choose. And then when David arrived, Hashem said to Shmuel, this is the one. This is the future king of Israel. So the question is, why Hashem did not tell him that from the beginning? And why Shmuel, he did not, when he arrived to Bethlehem, and they asked him, why did you come? Why didn't he tell him, I come to choose the new king of Israel from the family of Yishai? He said, I just came for a sacrifice. You know why? Because Shmuel and Levi said, I don't want to risk my life. Of course, Hashem told me to choose one son. But why didn't he tell me the name? Why Hashem didn't tell me the name? He just said, choose one from the children of Yishai. It's crazy. Why Hashem, he did not say to Shmuel, Shmuel, go to Bethlehem and choose David to be the future king of Israel. He said, just choose one of the children. But who? Who? So Shmuel and Navi said, if Hashem did not tell me which one, that means that Hashem wants to protect me. What protection? If I go with the idea that David is the king, that is a big danger. Because maybe in the meantime I will do a sin, I will do avera, and Shaul will kill me. From here you understand a mitzvah that you do, it protects you. But who knows how you do it? Even if you do, even that the mitzvah that you want to do, it could protect you, you have to take precautions if there is a danger in that mitzvah. If there is a danger in that mitzvah, you have to be careful. The mitzvah will protect you only with your protection, if you protect yourself as well. Do it with no danger, because you never know. Okay, Hashem will tell you, do this mitzvah protect you, but maybe in the meantime you do avera, you do a sin. So, you are not anymore protected. So, Avraham Avinu, he will not, God forbid, that the generation to come, they will not accuse Hashem why he said to Abraham, go to Egypt for food, and in the meantime something bad happened to his wife. So Abraham, he took a protection. He said, this is my sister. And then Sarah was taken to the house of Pharaoh. And then Pharaoh realized that she was not his sister, she was his wife. So why didn't tell me? I didn't tell you because if at why? Because I want you to take protection. But Hashem, he told you to go to Egypt, so Hashem will protect you. Yes, but maybe I will do a sin, and then I'll be no protection. But because I said it's my sister, even if I said it's my sister, I will not be punished. This is the same answer to Shmuel, the prophet Shmuel. The prophet Shmuel said to himself, why Hashem did not tell me which baby, which boy to choose to be a king? Because Hashem would protect me. Why? Because if I go with the knowledge that it's David, so then I will go to Bethlehem and I will say, I'm coming to choose David as a king. So he make himself in danger. You know, that was the Torah that the Jews in Egypt were learning. They were learning the stories about how Abraham is served Hashem. Believe me, when you learn, when you study how Abraham, Yitzhak and Yaakov served Hashem, that gives you love and pleasure to respect Hashem, to listen to whatever Hashem asks you. When the Torah starts with the creation of the world, why the Torah will not start with the mitzvot, the Ten Commandments? The Ten Commandments. That Hashem, this is the, because the Torah, it's what? The Torah, it's a mitzvot. It's like a Jewish program. How to be Jew. The Torah, it's a Jewish program. How to be Jew. So how to be Jew? Mitzvot. Those mitzvot, with those mitzvot, if you do them, if you respect them, you're a good Jew. Okay? So the Torah should start with this. Why the Torah start with stories? The creation of the world, the sin of Adam HaRishon, the Mabul, the deluge, you know, the Noah, or the, his generation, they drown the water, and then Abraham, all this. Why? We don't need all this. You know, the answer is, only through those histories, you know already your identity. I would like just to show you something. Let's say this is a passport. This passport, you have your picture, yes, and you have your name. Now, just imagine that you have a passport with no picture. Is there is no guarantee that this is your identity, that it's in this passport, that it's you. Maybe it's a passport of somebody else. Now let's see that you have only your picture without your name. That doesn't mean that you in the picture is the name that you declare. To make sure that your name is the name that it's in the passport in the picture. That means the picture identify this is your name, this is you need in the picture and the name, you understand? Both of them. When you have your picture and then you have your name, oh, it's you. Look, a lot of times you go to you pass the border and you see the police, you take the passport, he looked at the picture and he look at you. And then he look at your name. And then he say, David, if you don't answer, that means there is a problem. Yeah, David, yeah, oh, okay. Our identity is the Torah. If I want to be Pinto, descendants of Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, first, I have to know who they were. I have to know who's my father. Knowing who's my father, I want to know who's my grandfather. It's like he said it. Somebody I asked him, somebody, he came with a problem. I said, do you know who is Moshe Rabbeinu? He said, no. You know who is Abraham Avinu? He said, no. So I told him, so what do you know about the Judaism? You know what he said? You know what he said? Just imagine what he told me. He said, well, I know Paro. I said, Paro? The Pharaoh. But Paro is not your grandfather. You know any Paro? Yeah, because I saw a film. I saw a film talking about Paro, that he has some slaves. Only through the film you know that there is Paro? Do you know what it is to be a Jew? He said, yes, I am Jew. And your father, he's Jewish. But Jew, you keep something? No. What about Pesach? What is this Pesach? Passover. Yes, we do a lunch. A lunch with bread? Yes. Matzah? Yes. So you don't know who is Abraham, you don't know who is Isaac, you don't know who is Adam, nothing. I was very, 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 very sad for him. You know why? Because he has only one son. Only one son. And the son now, unfortunately, he went to Japan and he met somebody there. And he don't want no connection with his parents. And that's it. Now he's crying because he said, what about, I have only one, what about the future of my generation? I told him, the future of your generation, it was finished since you were born. Because your father did not give you your identity. You've been finished already. And then I realized that it was a big mistake because he was married to a non-Jew. So I said, anyway, your son, he's not Jewish. So he said, but I am Jewish. I said, no, you can only be Jewish if your wife, she's Jewish. So he was shocked. So sometimes you think you have an identity and you don't have it. You don't have it. The real identity is, who are my grandparents? Do I am like them? And my grandparent is not Pinto. It's not only my grandfather, my grandfather. No, it's still Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov. I learned first from them who they were, who they are. How they served Hashem. And through that, I know what I am. And according to what my parents did, and how they did everything not to accuse Hashem. Just imagine Avraham Avinu, they would kill his wife, or would they take his wife. He would accuse Hashem. Why has you did that to me? You told me to come to Eretz Israel, to Eretz Canaan. You told me it's the best. Then I realized it's the best. Then there is no food. You tell me, go to Egypt, and they took my wife. What's this? I about myself, I don't want to do any bad move that one day I will come to accuse Hashem. I do all kind of effort. Ishtadlut. I will do my best to protect myself, to protect my wife, and to protect God. So I will not accuse God. Because who knows, maybe I will do a sin. So if I do a sin, Hashem will not protect me. Because when Hashem says, go to Egypt, I will protect you, if it's one with one condition, if I am a tzaddik. But if I do something bad, I'm not protected anymore. As a matter of fact, that was Avraham Avinu. And because Avraham Avinu, he was such a tzaddik, he didn't want to come to this test, to accuse Hashem, he said, it's my sister. And anyway, Avraham Avinu said, I did not lie. Because a wife is her sister. If you love your wife, it's like your mother, it's like your sister. It's everything for you. That, now you understand that of the Torah, that the Jews, they were studying in Egypt. Now please listen to this. That now understand why Hashem, when he told them, do you want to accept my Torah? They said, Na'ase v'nishma. They said, of course, we'll do, we'll listen. I mean, you don't know what's going to give you, what Hashem is going to give you. How, you want to buy a business first. Before you buy the business, you take your lawyer, you take your, you know, you're an accountant, and you have to you know, last week, 2 weeks ago, I was in Los Angeles. There was a man that he wanted to sell his business. And he invited me to his, he has 1,000 people working there. He wants a bracha that those people will buy the business. And he told me, don't worry if you see there a lot of police, a lot of people. I said, why? He said, because they came to see if all the papers are right. And they've been working there for 1 month. It cost them a few million dollars, all the people that they were there to check that everything is correct. Understand? This is business. I mean, you want to sell the business, they want to buy the business, they have to know what they are buying. Understand? They have to know what they are buying. So, now, I mean, the Jews, Hashem proposed, do you want the Torah? They said yes. But hey, first, listen to what I propose you, and then say yes. I mean, the Jews could say to Moshe, Moshe, first let's hear what Hashem wants to give us, and we will accept. But the Jews said, we'll accept and we'll listen. That means, I accept before I listen. It's like, you propose me a business, I don't want any inventory, I want nothing, I just sign. I give you a white check. Here's, fill it up. It's not normal. So how the Jews really they accept it? You know why? Because of the histories. Because in Egypt, during the 400 years in Egypt, they were talking all the time about the Torah of Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov. About all what their parents did, how they served Hashem, how they loved Hashem, how Hashem loved them. You understand? Because of this, and then they saw that Hashem respected all the promises that he promised to Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov. So they said, we have to accept. If Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov, with all what we heard about them, all the Torah that they left for us, and they served Hashem with love, so we don't need any confirmation from somebody else. We believe, we trust, we do. We do. You know, I promise you, a lot of times I have some bad time. And sometimes I don't know how to take care of my problems sometimes. And always I bring an example from Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov. If they resisted all those tests, so my test is small compared to the test that they resisted. So I can do it. There was a man, a rabbi, who came to Chazon Ish. And he told him, Rabbi, I have a big problem. I have bad thoughts when I pray. What can I do? I don't know what to do. So the Chafetz Chaim said, take the Rambam, bring the Rambam. So he bring the Rambam, and the Chafetz Chaim was reading, the Chazon Ish was reading the Rambam. The Rambam said that a person who reads bad books, automatically he will have bad thoughts. So maybe if you have bad thoughts in the tefillah, maybe you see bad things, maybe you read bad books, so your mind is affected by the book. Clean your mind with the Torah. Clean your mind with the histories of Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov. And you will have no bad thoughts anymore when you pray. There was a Chavis Rav Kalaski was here this morning. We talked a little bit. And he brought me, you know, a Chavetz Chaim. A Chavetz Chaim who said that the only way, he said that sometimes you ask for a tea. So a tea is, you bring a hot tea. This hot tea, if you put it in another glass, the tea will be cold. So you put it in another glass, so it's koshlishi, so it will be more cold. Then the more you change the tea to another glass, it will be more and more cold. But that the tea will remain hot should be the first glass. So the Chafetz Chaim said, to be keeping warm with the Torah, always you have to study Torah. But if you stop, so you become second glass. No more you stop, you will get cold and cold and cold. Then till you disconnect yourself from the Torah, from Hashem. So the Jews in Israel thought that was good. So I said to Abraham Kalaski, now understand why Amalek came to fight the Jews. Because the Jews, when they were in the desert, they prepared themselves to receive the Torah. And so at the main time that they were preparing, they started to relax. Rafui dehem divrei Torah. They started to relax. The more they started to relax, they become cold. So that's why Amalek came to fight them. Why Amalek came to fight them? Because they were cold. The only protection that you can have only when you are warm with the Torah. The Orech Chaim HaKadosh, he was a big tzaddik, he said, what that mean? Vayis'u merfidim, the travel from Refidim, he said, after the war with Amalek, they understood because they were cold in the Torah, because they studied Torah relaxed, they become cold. Now they become warm. Now they started really to do Torah mitzvot. That's the way they want to receive the Torah. That's the way. So you see, this is the our preparation now for Pesach to Matan Torah. We count the Omer every day. We count. We have to count 50 days, 7 weeks. 7 weeks. Why we have to count? Why you have to count? To make yourself sure, are you really want the Torah or not? You really, it's like a, just imagine a couple that they are engaged. And you see that the Chatan, he don't care about looking for a house. He don't care about preparing, you know, where to be the wedding, the ketubah, the catering, no cards, nothing. But he fixed a date. But nothing is ready. So his fiance, she asked him, hey, Moshe, really, do you want to marry me or not? Of course. But I see no preparation. See, 2 days, we have only 2 days left to get married. You did no cards, no musicians, nothing ready. I forgot. This is love. Huh? I'm sorry, I forgot. It's too late, I don't know. No. I don't want to marry a man like you. You're not a man. Your mind is, I don't know, where is your mind? That's what Hashem gave us, 50 days. Preparation for Matan Torah, to receive the... If the Torah is... If there is a value of the Torah, so you prepare yourself. You count every day. You count every day. And every day that comes, you're excited to receive the Torah. You're excited. Yes. So Hashem is happy. And the Torah, she's happy. Because the Torah, it's like our wife, the Torah. She's happy. She's excited to get married. She's excited to come down. Because she sees that really we want her. We want the Torah. We want the Matan Torah. But if we are caught, if our mind is business, television, football, the Torah, she's not happy. Hashem is happy to give the Torah. But are you happy to get it? You're happy if Hashem propose you, I give you money? You're happy to receive it. What about the Torah? So that's what we have to prepare. From Pesach till Shavuot, preparation. And of course, the best thing that you have to know, before you know who is Hashem, before you know what is the Torah, first, do you know from where you come from? Do you know that who is Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov? Do you know what they did? Their life is the Torah. Before you study the laws, first you study those who respected those laws and how, what sacrifice they did to respect those laws. Do you know them? No. If you don't know them, this story is not for you. I promise you, you cannot value the Torah if you don't know who is your parent. Who is Abraham? Who is Yitzhak? How did they live? In which condition they love Hashem? Never they ask to Hashem why. I finish with this. It's like Hashem, he said to Abraham, Abraham, he was 100 years old. Abraham, you're going to have a baby boy. From this baby boy, you will have the Jewish people, generations, and I choose them. Abraham, he could not have children. And Sarah, she was as well, she could not have children. No mattress, nothing. And suddenly, a bigness. She was 90, he was 100 years old, and he's a baby. It's hard. 37 years later, Yitzhak was a big tzaddik, and Hashem said to Abraham, Abraham, I want you to take Yitzhak, sacrifice him. Abraham could say to Hashem, Hashem, but for years you promised me that from you out of me you will bring generation to serve you. And then you give me Yitzhak. Now you tell me to sacrifice Yitzhak. Where did your promise? Even that, Abraham did not ask. He just took Yitzhak to sacrifice him. The question is, it was very risky, because Yitzhak Avinu, he could say to Abraham, what do you want, Papa, for me? Well, Hashem wanted to sacrifice you. Yitzhak could say to Abraham, Abraham, you think I'm a baby? You want to sacrifice me? Sacrifice yourself. Why me? I don't want to listen to you. Do you think Hashem told you this? And Yitzhak, he did not say nothing. He just followed his father, like a lamb. And then he gave his neck to Abraham to do the shechita. That was the kind of education that Abraham gave to Yitzhak. That was the kind of love that Hashem gave to Yitzhak, to love Hashem. So when Abraham said to Yitzhak, Hashem told me to sacrifice you, he did not say no. Papa, do as Hashem wants you to do. If you know that, well, if that is in your blood, so you can accept the Torah that Hashem gives you. Otherwise, it's a problem. That's why on Pesach we talk a lot of about Hashem, miracles. Then, through that, we go to prepare ourselves for the Torah. So now, I would like just to make it short about the question that we ask, why Abraham Avinu has to lie to Pharaoh to tell him it's my sister Sarah, it's not my wife. So as we said, that Abraham Avinu was afraid from the Chilul Hashem. He was afraid, maybe, of course, he accept the order of Hashem, but he was worried that people will accuse Hashem if something happened to him. So he had to take some precautions. He didn't want to rely on the miracle. That's why he said, it's my sister. Because who knows, maybe he can do either a fault, a sin, and if he does a sin, he has no more protection from Hashem. So if he gets killed, because he said, sorry, it's my wife, so they would kill him to take his wife. So people would talk, why Hashem did not protect him? That's why Avraham Avinu, he took protection. It's like the Shemitah. The Shemitah, a lot of people, there is some mitzvah that Hashem tell you to do, that Hashem will not tell you something to do that you cannot do. Hashem can't. If Hashem told you to the mitzvah, even that the mitzvah is very, very hard to do it, that means that you can't do it. It seems, it looks like it's impossible to do it, but you can do it. Because the Shemitah, you can do it, because Hashem, he promised you, do it, keep, don't work 6 years, the 7 years, don't plant, don't put water on the land, don't work your land, and don't think what's going to eat later. I promise you. There is some mitzvah that there is a promise from Hashem that there is nothing to worry, but there is some mitzvah, there is no promise. Like the one that Hashem said to Shmuel, go choose one son from the son of Yishai. That was there, no promise that Hashem would protect Shmuel. So that way Hashem, Shmuel, he takes some protection that, God forbid, if that he did not say that, he said to the people of Bethlehem, Hashem sent me to do a sacrifice. Because he had no protection. Look, just imagine if something would happen to him. Shaul would hear that Shmuel, he took another king. He would kill him. But Hashem, he gave him another to do it. Even that, Shmuel and Levi was worried. Maybe in the meantime that he would do what Hashem wants from him. Maybe he would do a Avera. Anyway, Avraham Avinu, he didn't want to rely on miracles. Even Yaakov Avinu, before he meets Esav, even that he had promises from Hashem that he has nothing to worry from Esav, he prepared, he prayed, he sent presents, and he prepared himself for a war. But Hashem promised him not to worry. Still, he was worried. And he hid Dinah, that he wouldn't look at her. Esav, why he did all this? Because he was worried. Maybe in the meantime that he will finish meeting Esav, maybe he is doing a Avera, then he will be punished. So that's why Avraham, Avinu, Avraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, Shmuel, didn't want to rely on miracles. This is the way. So why did he do that? So, God forbid, they will not, Chas v'Shalom, do a Chilul Hashem. Maybe they will be punished. Maybe something bad will happen to him, and people, they will accuse God. Why Hashem? He did not protect them. A lot of times there is Midat Hadin, when there is something, a mitzvah that you have to do. There is always midat adin to stop you not to do it. But there is some mitzvot that there is no way you have to do them. There you are putting compassion. I wish you all the best and God bless you.
I'm